Hello and welcome to our family service this morning for Croftlands Community Church. We do hope that you are well, and whether it's your first time with us or whether you're here every week, you're very welcome. Now, we have some birthdays this week to celebrate. It's Barbara Spence and Jean Broadhurst, both on Tuesday the 31st. So happy birthday to you for Tuesday. Here's some lovely flowers for you. Let's pray as we start our service. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your presence. We thank you that although we might be gathering in each other's homes, you are present with us in each and every one of them. Lord, thank you that you bless us with so many things. We pray this morning that as we worship together, your Holy Spirit will just touch us where we need to be touched by you this morning. We ask this in your precious name. Amen. Now we'll sing our first song of worship.
Worship One day, Jesus told his disciples
and a whole bunch of other people
a parable,
which is a heavenly story that has an earthly meaning.
No, it's an earthly story that has a heavenly meaning.
Right. So what was it about?
Well, there was a certain man who was going away and he called in three of his servants.
Was he rich then, this man?
We'll find out soon.
Okay.
So, to the first man he gave 5 talents, the second one 2 talents, and the third one he gave 1 talent.
So he wasn't rich, then only giving 5 talents, 2 talents, and then 1. What's a talent? Is it like playing football or something?
No! In the time of Jesus, a talent was a sum of money.
So he wasn't rich then at all.
Ah, but 1 talent was like 20 years worth of wages.
So he was rich in fact, he was loaded.
You could say that, yes. Anyway, back to the parable that Jesus told.
Okay.
Once he'd given the talents to the servants, he then went on a long journey to a distant land.
Did he go like first class because he was loaded?
He may have travelled in some style, but as for first class, I don't think that they used that term back then.
If I had all that money to give to people, when I went away, I'd travel first class. Stay in the best hotels, eat the best food.
We are getting off the point.
Sorry, carry on.
While he was away for a very long time, the servants that had the 5 talents and the 2 talents made more talents, each doubling what they had.
So the one that had 5 talents made 5 more, the one with 2 made 2 more. Whoa, and you said talents was like 20 years of wages, so 5 would be like 100 years of wages, which then you double that, then it's...
A lot of money.
Yeah.
However, the one with the 1 talent just dug a hole and hid it away to keep it safe.
Well, that might make sense, but perhaps a bit pointless.
True. Then the man came home and asked to see the servants.
Uh-oh.
You might well say that. The first servant came in and handed over the first 5 talents and the 5 that he'd made. The second did the same, handing over the 2 and the extra 2 he'd made. And then the third servant came in.
I hope he washed it after he dug it up.
That was going to be the least of his problems. The man was so disappointed in him for not doing something worthwhile with the money that he threw him out and took the 1 talent he had and gave it to the servant with the 5 talents. And that was in addition to giving both the first and second servants promotions and putting them in charge of loads of other things.
So I guess you could say that whatever we have, we should use wisely.
Take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, set me on fire. Oh, take all I have in these hands and multiply, God, all that I am, and find my heart on the altar again. Set me on fire, well, set me on fire. Here I am, God, arms wide open, pouring out my life. In awe of your name, your mighty love stands strong to the end. You will fulfill your purpose for me. You won't forsake me. You will be with me. Here I am, God. Here I am. now. All to Jesus now. Holding nothing back. Holding nothing back. I surrender. Following on from that story from Matthew, that dramatised story from Matthew, we know that a talent in the time of Jesus was a sum of money, equivalent to 20 years' wages. A talent today could still be classed as that, but it's also looked at in the English language as more of an ability or a capability, something that we can do, or a gift that we've been given, or we've developed in some way. Every one of us has a gift or a talent. And God has given them to us according to our circumstances, our situation that we're currently in at that time, because it might be given for a short time, our abilities, what we do, what we need them for. We don't all get the same number of talents or gifts, neither do we all get them all the same. That would make us really boring if we all had the same gifts and talents. Imagine, for example, if we all had the gift of sport. Sport might be great for some people, but then, who would it be that would make all the sports equipment? Who would build the football stadiums? And who would make the sports kits? Surely that requires gifts and talents too, to make all of those things. So you might be into sport, in the fact you watch it, but you might be into sport because you actually play it, or even just into sport because you make, with your talents and gifts, the kit that goes with playing sport. I'm sure you get the idea. God wants us to use our gifts and our talents to spread the gospel message about how much he loves us and to encourage people to become followers of him. Now, many people get really, really hung up on the things that they can't do rather than thinking about the things that they can do. Thinking back for a moment to that parable that we've heard. One was given 5 talents and one was given 2. Now, the one with the 2 didn't look at the one with the 5 and start to complain and say, hang about, because I've not got 5, I've got 3 less than you, I've got 2, I'm not going to do anything with mine. No, they both in equal measure put the talent that they had to good use, and both of their talents were doubled, which the master upon his return commended them for, and if you like, promoted them to a higher office. Some Christians too get really hung up on the idea of talents and gifts and things like that, and they say, I don't have that particular gift, or I don't have that gift, I wish I had that gift, I could use that in some way or other. Very often people say that I couldn't go and stand up and preach. I couldn't witness my faith to a person that I work with, etc. God isn't calling us to do that. He's calling us to use what we have been given for him. Let me explain how that can work. Let's say, for example, that you have a gift or a talent that has enabled you to get a really good job over the years. Maybe you've been promoted several times. Maybe you're in the process of still being promoted today. Maybe you don't have that gift of spreading the gospel in that way, but you can use the money and the revenue from what you do earn as your job, using your skills, gifts and talents, to give to those people that do, such as missionaries or other organisations that do go out and spread the word. It might be also, as a result of the job that you have done for many years, that you've got a nice house. Do you know, I wonder how many kitchen sinks, dining room tables, kitchen ovens and all those kind of things have been used as pulpits without people even realising that they were actually being used that way. You may be able to offer hospitality to people because you've got the gifts and talents that have given you a good job, so it's given you a nice big house, and use your gifts and your talents in a different way in preaching the gospel around your kitchen table. I don't even know that you've been doing it. That's a bit like how Alpha works, because it always starts with a meal prepared in a kitchen by somebody with skillful hands, but maybe that kitchen is somebody else's kitchen, not necessarily yours. Remembering to the beginning of the Gospels when Jesus called Peter, Peter the fisherman. I love Peter the fisherman. He very much reminds me of myself, getting things wrong, putting my foot in it, only opening my mouth, sometimes I change my feet and that. But what did Peter have? Well, Peter had the necessary equipment, skills and also talents to be able to navigate the waters on the Sea of Galilee. And he made his boat readily available to Jesus to use. And Jesus said, I'm going to make you into a fisher of men. A few weeks ago, in a word for the day on Saturday the 10th of July, it was summarised in this way about what happened when Jesus called Peter. And he says this, he says, Peter first used his boat for Jesus and gave it over to him. Jesus' response to that was he blessed Peter and Peter's boat and used it to take care of everything else. Because there was an abundant load of fish that was caught. That is recorded beginning of the Gospels and also the end of the Gospels. Jesus said the following words in Matthew 6 and 33. He said this, he said, seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. When we talk about gifts, many Christians think about the gifts of the Holy Spirit, as mentioned in the letters that Paul wrote. But what about other gifts that we've got? Think about the job that you've got and the training that you went to get to that job, the training you've done while you've been in that job, or think of a hobby that you've got, or just a pure interest that has led to a new skill that you have developed. Surely these are also gifts and talents that are God-given. So they might be natural to you, but actually they're also God-given supernatural gifts that he can use for his work in the kingdom. Now, I like to tell stories. I love to listen to stories. I love to tell stories. And I also have an interest in history. And particularly, I love biblical history. And when you combine the two together, I like to tell the stories that we read about in the Bible. Now, I believe that it's a gift that God has been developing in me for a number of years now. As a result of which, I have been collecting things. I'm not a collector maniac, but I've been collecting things that will help me. Because the stories that I like to tell are to children. And over here, I've got a whole collection of different props that over the years I have managed to amass. Now, if the camera can just kind of pan round and look at some of these items on these shelves here. Some of them are going to look rather unusual. Okay, rather unusual things. I wonder how many Bible stories you can actually discover from what you see around you here. I'm going to point some out to you in a moment. Okay, we've got some rather odd ones actually. So there we go. Let's see if we can point some of these things out to you. Over here, I've got a couple of pairs of dark glasses. Now, where in the Bible the people wore dark glasses? You will never get it, because they didn't actually wear dark glasses, but they went in disguise. They went sneaking around because it's about the 12 spies that are in Numbers 13, or the two spies that Joshua sent into the Promised Land that we here read about in Joshua chapter 2. Okay, what else have I got on here? Here's one that's going to really... You might get this one, actually. I've got here a plastic tent peg. Okay. Where in the Bible is a tent peg mentioned? Bit of a gruesome one. It's a red tent peg, actually. It's a bit of an indication of what it was used for. It's actually in the book of Judges, chapter 4. And it's the story... It features in the story of Deborah. If you want to read it, it's a bit gruesome. Read it yourself. Okay. A few other odd things around here as well. Up here, I've got... Now, this is a really odd one, this one. I have got here a... well, actually, it's a curtain pole, to be quite... I'm not going to beat about the bush. It's a curtain pole with a rather ornate end on the end of it. So where in the Bible would a curtain pole figure, you're wondering? Well, let me just tell you this. If I was somebody that was royal and regal, I could hold this. You know, this could be my sceptre of office. Where is there a sceptre in the Bible that has to be raised in order for somebody to speak? Of course, it's the story of Esther. And King Xerxes held the sceptre. He had so much power, he didn't need swords and things. He had a sceptre to control the people. The sceptre, or curtain pole, whichever you prefer. What else have we got on our... we've got some pretty obvious ones, really. Over here, I've got rather large pole, javelin. And I've got a spear. I've got a rather large sword. And over here, I've got a little pouch and a little stone. Of course, they all feature in the story of David and Goliath. Okay, so we've got Samuel chapter 1 and 1 Samuel 17, should I say. Up here we've got some Egyptian headgear. Of course, that is the story of Joseph that we can read about in Genesis 41 onwards. Okay, what else have I got here? Oh yes, I've got a little pot down here which is full of red lentils. Of course, that's the story that we read about in Genesis 25 of Jacob and Esau on the birthright story. So, lots of things that you can hold in your hand and I can tell a story from them. The point is this, is that whatever God has given you in your hand, whatever gift or whatever talent that you've got, can be used in some way to tell people about the person that gave it to you. The gift or the talent in particular. You think about Moses, for example. Moses was challenged by God. He was a shepherd. Challenged by God, and God asked him the question. He said, Moses, what have you got in your hand? And Moses said, I've got my staff. And it was that same staff that was then used to turn into a snake. It was used to part the Red Sea. It was used to guide the people, get water from rock. God used him and used what he had in his hand at the time to bring about a great deliverance. So I say again, what gift, what talent, what skill, what ability, what have you got in your hands that you can use for God? I want to finish off with some words from Paul's letter to the Colossians. Some words to think about today, and it says this. It says, whatever you do, whether in word or in deed, do it all for the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him.
I want to serve the purpose of God in my generation. I want to serve the purpose of God while I am alive. I want to give my life that'll last forever. Oh, I delight to do your will. What is on your heart? Show me what to do. Let me know your will and I will follow you. What is on your heart? Show me what to do. Let me know. I want to build with silver and gold in my with silver and gold while I am alive. I want to give my life for something that will last forever. Oh, I delight to do your will. The kingdom of God while I am alive. I want to give my life for something that'll last forever.
Let's join together in the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.